Hey, no, 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 you can't get away. Get over here. Big baby. Huh. Look what I found. I don't know what that is. Some kind of fuzzy caterpillar. There's a lot of these, but there's also this other kind that I'm seeing all over the place, and I don't know what kind of caterpillars these are or why they're here. Hold on, let me go grab the other one and I'll show you that. Maybe you can identify it. This other one is black on both ends and then kind of a reddish brown in the middle. And I'm not sure if that's called a woolly caterpillar or not. I'm really not sure. And then there's this other one. But the big one, they're all over the place. And I don't know. Whoa, there we go. Time to go. All right. Well, I don't know what they are, but I do know that they're not eating my garden, at least not right. What were you doing there? Don't eat the hair off my hands. I don't know what they're doing here, but they're actually kind of cool. They're all over the place. One thing I did notice is that the chickens won't eat them. Nope, chickens won't have anything to do with them, so they're pretty much safe from my flock. And there's all kinds of weird creatures floating all over the air lately. It's really kind of strange. The seasons changed. Autumn came in, and then everything just turned different. I don't know how to explain it. The caterpillars came in. The garden just basically stopped. It's like it's frozen in time. It's not growing. It's not dying. It's not doing anything. It's like somebody took a picture of my garden and just put it out in my yard. I don't know what's going on with that. The sunchoke's got all the yellow flowers and stuff. But also, one of the bad things about autumn is that the predators are starting to come in closer into the property. And during the summer, they're out there, they're eating rabbits, mice, I don't know what they're all eating, but they're eating something and it's way out there. But when autumn comes along and the harvest is done, because I'm in farm country, what the farmers do is they come along with their combines and they harvest their crops. Well, there isn't as much area for things to hide out, you know, like the predators, so they're out in the open, and also the prey goes into hiding as well. So now they're coming in a little bit closer. And I had a bit of a run-in the other day, and it's not a good thing, so I'll just come right out and say it. Butter was killed. Yeah, my turkey Butter. Remember that pretty yellow and white one? She was killed and eaten by coyotes just a few days ago. And I didn't know where she was. I was looking all over for her. I couldn't find her for 2 days. And so I went on this hunt all over my property. I looked underneath every single tree and in every single tree and under every bush, 3 acres of property. And that's a lot when you're looking underneath everything and in the weeds and stuff. And right behind this fenced area, right on the other side of the fence, literally up against the fence, was her nest. She had decided to make a nest out there. She didn't want to make a nest in the coop. And I can understand that. Turkeys like to do it off in a distance. They like their privacy, unlike chickens who will just, they'll lay an egg on a plate. But turkeys, they like to kind of go underneath branches and stuff. I had 80 acres a while back when I had my house up north. I had 80 acres. My turkeys would always leave the yard and go out into the woods to lay their eggs. Problem was, there was predators. There was foxes up there. There was a bobcat, bear, all kinds of stuff. There was coyotes up there, or wolves, I don't know what it was, some kind of doggy looking thing. But anyway, they would come in and they would eat the turkeys right off the nest. Well, out here, the only thing we've seen is coyotes, but they kind of kept their distance. Every now and then they'd come in close, but they didn't hurt anything. And I didn't think much of it, and that was my mistake. And Butters paid the price for my mistake. So, yeah, that is my fault. And so Butter died, and I felt really kind of bad about that. I still do feel really kind of bad about that. But it's the cycle of life. It's just how things are. No matter what you do, no matter how careful you are, things are going to happen. Things are going to go wrong. And I've learned to accept that, you know. I change what I can. I control what I can. And then the things that I can't control, I just accept. And that's just how it works. And Rascal, you know, what's really kind of weird is this morning, I noticed that Rascal had been going out ever since we found the remains of Butters, which was just a couple tufts of feathers. And what Rascal had been doing for the last couple days, he's been going out there every morning and peeing and barking right where Butter got attacked. And he knows what was going on. He knows it's some kind of predator. So he's trying to mark his territory and trying to keep things out as much as he can. And He really tries awful hard, but he's just one little tiny brisket dog. I joke about him. He's got the heart of a lion, but he's got the body of a brisket. He's just itty bitty, and he can't really do much. And I can watch out for the birds as much as I possibly can, but I can't watch them 24 hours a day. And there's a fine line between the freedom that I want to give my animals and the safety I want to give my animals. And sometimes that fine line, I get on the wrong side of it, and the birds get on the other side of it, and things happen and things go wrong. So I wanted to bring that to your attention because it's just one of those realities of living out here. And people do mention, Ray, it's so beautiful out there and you live this idyllic lifestyle. But there's also a downside, you know. There are predators out here, and I've taken a stand that I will not kill animals. I just won't do that. I used to back in the day, and I, you know, back in the day, if something attacked my flock, I'd be the first one out there with a shotgun, blow their little heads off. Yep, I used to do that, and I didn't feel bad about it at all. But something came my way, and it was those foxes. Remember way back, I took care of those orphaned baby foxes because coyotes killed their mother, the mother fox. And my dogs found the babies outside their den, which you'll never find unless the mother's dead. And the, so I took care of the babies for a few weeks and then gave them to the Audubon Society to rehab. And from what I understand, they rehabbed them and let them loose in southwest Minnesota where there wasn't so much population. So they're living happy and healthy. The thing about that is it changed my life. And it was definitely a life-changing experience. I looked into the eyes of what I considered the enemy. And from then on, they weren't the enemy because I just could not bring myself to step over that line and to kill anymore. I don't fault other people for what they do and how they care for their flock and how they go out and hunt and stuff like that. That's not my business to get into your business. But my business was I decided right then and there that I'm not going to kill anything anymore. And that's just how I'm going to live my life. And I'm comfortable with that. If you're not comfortable with it, then you're the one having the problem. It's my life, and that's how I choose to do it. So sometimes I may lose a member of my flock, and I take the responsibility for that, and I'm going to make things a little bit more secure. So I expanded their fenced area so they'll have more room to roam, so they'll have less reason to try and get over the fence. And next year, I'm going to try and add a couple more feet onto the fencing to try to keep the birds in. I'll do the best that I possibly can with what I have to work with to keep my animals safe and happy and healthy without actually going out and killing everything in nature that wants to eat my animals. Because in all fairness, I'm living in their territory. They're not living in mine. They were here long before I was. And there's farmers here, there's people here, and these creatures out here, the hawks, the snakes, the coyotes, all of these wild creatures, they have to kind of dance in between our habitat to try to eke out a living. And sometimes they cross the line. And so sometimes we're gonna have a problem. So I just wanted to make that clear. Butter is no more. I still have 15 more birds, and I hope I don't lose any more. Chances are I will lose a few throughout the years, but I guess we'll just cross that bridge when we come to it. But anyway, that is that. Hey, look, compost, and it's hot. It's actually hot. I'm sitting right next to a very hot compost pile. I cleaned out, I needed to get out here and recharge after dealing with butter. So I came out and I raked out the coop. And I got all that poop and wood shavings and stuff from when I had the goats and the turkeys. And I laid it out, moistened it, mowed some grass, piled that on, laid some more shavings down and stuff. And so I kind of lasagna layered this on top of each other. And boy, is it cooking nicely. This is going to be some good compost for the garden to get it going next year. But I have some things I need to harvest. So let's head over there, okay? Ugh. Get my big butt up off this ground. Ow, my leg went to sleep. Oh. You gotta go. You know, whenever I cut stuff out of the garden, I have this really, I think it's a bad habit. I should be taking this stuff, holding on to it, and taking it out to the compost pile, but I get lazy because I kind of get into the groove. And so what I'm doing is I cut off things and I throw it over that way. And I figure, well, there's a little grassy area there. I always start up the riding lawnmower, and I figure I'll just hit it with the riding lawnmower and it'll just compost down and feed my lawn. Well, it doesn't quite work like that. And I'll show you in a second, okay? Remind me, as soon as I'm done with this, showing you this, I want to show you what happens when you get lazy, okay? This is lazy gardening. But this thing right here, first of all, look at this. This is that casa banana. It started out over there. Remember I mentioned it went all over here and it went down over there. Well, it also decided to go over here. So, you know what's really weird? I could have just planted one seed and had a whole freaking garden. That plant literally took over one, two, three raised beds. It's going nuts. And it's not going to produce anything else, but I just can't bring myself to tear it apart because it's actually quite beautiful. But I do have to harvest something today because it's getting colder and colder, and I don't want to take a chance on these things freezing. Right here, right next to the sunflower, I had planted a pumpkin on a stick. Remember pumpkin on a stick? Yeah, I planted a pumpkin on a stick and an okra side by side. And I had all these grand plans this year. I was going to have pumpkin on a stick. I was going to have an okra. I was going to have two sunflowers. I was going to have all these potatoes. And yeah, it didn't work out quite that way. First off, the okra was doing good, and then the pumpkin on a stick found some good soil down there, sent down some roots and grew up, and it totally killed the okra. So yeah, the okra went bye-bye. The okra needs warm weather to go really, really good. So before the weather got warm, the pumpkin on a stick took over. You really got to think about what you're going to plant before you plant it, because if you do like me, you'll end up with these weird plants that just hate each other. And that's what happened. This guy just beat the heck out of it. You know what's really weird? One seed, and these were sent to me by a viewer, I believe, sent me these seeds for pumpkin on a stick. I thought, well, that's kind of cool because they look like little red pumpkins, you know, and they grow on a plant. And it's a novelty plant, but you can eat them. And I think in the Philippines, they actually have a dish. Oh, here comes Rascal. They have a dish for pumpkin on a stick, but I'm not going to eat them because you know me, I don't like eggplant. But I want to show you this. Take a look at all of this is nuts. And I've already harvested, I don't know, I think about 30 or 40 of these. But towards the end of the season is when they went crazy. I could actually decorate my house with this. Isn't that beautiful? The colors, they got them from green to yellow to orange. Let me pop one of these off. I got a couple of them here. I wanted to show you these up close and personal because they're beautiful. Look at the tops. They're very ornate. They look like something out of a craft store. And they look like little pumpkins, don't they? Isn't that cute? You could decorate for Halloween with these things all over your house, or you could string them together and hang them. Yeah, that would actually make a really good project. But you can also eat these. And inside, let me just break one of these open. I dry these out in my basement. I just pick them and put them in the basement. But this is what they look like. I can't get my hands through the fence. Ah. Look at that. Kind of juicy on the inside. And lots of seeds. Let me sniff this. Let's see what it smells like, okay? Smells like a gourd. Yeah. Yep. Definitely. Smells like a gourd. But I got green ones, I got flowers, I got these red ones, and you know what? This is one plant. This is just one little stem off of one plant. Oh, no. This is not it. Take a look at what this plant is doing. I wouldn't show you something if it was just ordinary. It's got to be extraordinary to make this program. Take a look over here. Okay, the stem I showed you was right back here with all of that on there. Now, this is all one plant. I've been pruning it back because it just grows out of control. I haven't been pruning it to make it bush out. I just pruned it back because it was taking over everything. And, what's going on over here? Let go. Big buggers. Look at that. That's just nuts. That's another one. And here's another one. Oh yeah, it doesn't stop. Oh, no. I told you this was phenomenal. Look at this. There's that. Oh yeah, we're still going. And then we've got that. And we've got that. Okay, I can't hold anymore. I gotta put these things down. There's more stems, but yeah, you get the idea. It's crazy. One freaking seed. This is just nuts. You can grow enough of these to decorate everybody's house. Or if you eat these, which you can, they're just a little bitter, but they use them in, I think, Philippine cooking, in stir fries and soups and stuff like that. So they're definitely edible. Not a problem with edible. And they're very prolific. They're still putting out endless flowers, new fruits, growing. And bugs have eaten them. The sun scorched them. They've wilted. They've gotten trampled on. They've been through heck. And they're still a trooper. Let me tell you something. I wish I liked these things to eat. I would grow nothing but these. I could grow, like, out of just this one bed, I could grow enough to feed a family of 12 for a year. That's just crazy. I had to take a short break because I found this. Yep. And whenever I find these, I stop anything I'm doing and I come inside because my little special bird is waiting for me in here. No, it's not Tiny Tim. Amazingly enough, Tiny Tim gets around extremely well and has been helping herself to everything. She is getting stronger and stronger. But remember the little turkey I mentioned that has a bad leg? Yeah, it doesn't get out that often. It just kind of sits in here, and you can hear it calling to me. Yep. And when I catch a bug, I bring it in here, and I get my shoelace untied. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, if you could just tie the darn things, you'd be very helpful. But in between all of this mess, I like to give her a special treat. That was good, huh? That was really good. Okay, back to the garden. Yeah. What a jungle. Yeah, it's definitely a jungle over here. But I like it that way. I like it really green. Over on this end of the garden, actually, this isn't even the garden. This is the outside area that I was mentioning earlier where I just throw my stuff. This is kind of like my trash pile. But it's supposed to be grass, but there's a lot more things growing than grass. I really have very little grass over here. It's mostly dandelions, thistle, miscellaneous. Ooh, little red things. I don't know what these things are. But yeah, this is where I throw everything, and I just found this the other day. Take a look at what I found here out of my trash pile. Yeah, it's exactly what it looks like. It's a green bean plant. It's a Landreth stringless green bean. Remember I was growing these in the raised bed right over here? Well, when I cleared out the green beans earlier this summer, I'm thinking like, what, was it a month ago or more? Yeah, I just ripped them out and I threw some of the vines over here and I was going to throw them in the compost pile. Well, I never got around to it. I guess there must have been a bean or something on them. But what happened is, look, they grew. Yeah, the beans sprouted, they grew, and I have bean flowers. So I might even get, yeah, this is nothing. This is nothing. It's just a little tiny plant. But it amazes me how well these things, they survive. They are definitely survivors. I come over here and every day I pick these dandelions. I don't yank them out because I don't want to get rid of them. I want to harvest them. This is actually a food source for my birds. And since they can't get out in free range as much as I want them to do, I come around and I pick all these dandelion leaves and I pick them up just like this, and I take them in there and I throw them into the birds, and they love these things. It's good nutrition for them. It gets rid of some dandelion leaves, and plus I like to do it. But I saw this, and I thought, ah, beans! And when I looked around, I found something else over here, right over here. Yeah, it's a pea vine. Yeah, so I was growing peas, the sugar snap peas, and apparently I must have thrown a vine over here. So now I got peas, I got beans, and I'm looking around thinking, what else did I throw over here? I have no idea what's over here. Oh, look. One of those nasty little bugs that I don't like. Yep, these are those Asian beetles. Yep, just waiting to bite me, little bugger. Well, this is stone cold dead. Kind of weird. Yeah, it's garden cleanup. That's what autumn's all about, is garden cleanup and prepping for the winter for me. And I see a lot of these, and I harvest these too. These are called asparagus berries. These are my asparagus ferns here. I got two little asparagus beds. And then once I harvest all the tomatoes and that casa banana and the peppers and stuff, I'm going to clear that out, fill it full of compost, and then dig up those roots for the other asparagus patch. Remember the original one? Yep. I'm going to dig up those roots, transplant them over here. I'll do an episode on that and show you how I do it. But for right now, these things are putting out berries, and they're actually beautiful. They're actually beautiful berries. Take a look at these. You may see these on your asparagus. They'll start out green, and then they'll turn red. These are called asparagus berries. And what they are is nothing more than a seed pod. You pluck this off, and I just dry the pods out downstairs. But let me show you up close what this looks like. If you squeeze them, see? There's about three seeds inside each pod. Yep. I dry the pods and then I crack them open and I get the asparagus seeds out of them. You can just squeeze them out like this and then throw the red part away and dry these seeds off on a paper plate or something like that. Yes, you can definitely do these. And as soon as they're dry, you can store them and then plant these, and these will grow asparagus plants. There's a myth that goes around, and it's just a misunderstanding. I won't actually classify it as a myth. I'll just classify it as a misunderstanding to give everybody the benefit of the doubt. People will tell you that asparagus berries are poisonous, so don't ever eat those or feed them to your animals. That's actually not true, folks. There are two different kinds of asparagus plants. There are asparagus, which is what you grow out in your garden that you eat, and there's also what's called asparagus ferns, which are the indoor plants that you see people growing inside. Those are a totally different plant. That is not the same plant as these asparagus. Now, those asparagus ferns and the berries, I think all parts of those are poisonous. Avoid those like the plague if you have kids or animals and you don't want to be shoving them in your kid's mouth. These are asparagus berries, and unless you're terribly allergic to asparagus, which I don't know if anybody really, I don't know, is there such a thing? But anyway, for the normal, everyday person, these are not poisonous, okay? You can eat these. Nobody wants to eat these because they taste like crap. But I'm just saying, they're not poisonous. Don't worry about them. You're not going to die or anything like that. I just wanted to clear that up because sometimes gardening misconceptions get spread, and then if you don't correct them soon enough, they'll turn into myths. And then myths, eventually, if they're spread enough, people take them as facts, and then when somebody comes along with the actual facts, people yell at them and go, "No, I heard different." Well, you know what? It's not true, okay? These are not poisonous, they're not gonna hurt you, nothing's gonna come up and grab you by the throat. Don't worry about it. Yeehaw, time to yank this bad boy up. Yep, I could let this grow until frost takes it, but I wanna harvest as many of these as possible, and I really don't need a ton of them, so I'm gonna yank up this pumpkin on a stick and harvest the berries. Holy Moses, look at you. This is nuts. Okay, well, I'm not gonna lift the whole thing up because I'm not strong enough. Let's shake off the dirt, and that should make it just a little bit easier on me. Wow, nice roots on this thing. All right. Let's just stand little Ray up on his garden bed, and yowza. Take a look at this. Eh. Thing is freakishly huge. Yeah? Even Rascal don't want to stand too close to it. What do you think? Is this beautiful or what? Yeah, I'm going to just pose for a picture here. Okay, well, I think I'll take a screenshot off of that. Wow. Is that a beauty or what? That is amazing. One last shot, okay? All kinds of good stuff all the way around this. And the root system, yeah, I broke a lot of the roots off, but yeah, it had a beautiful root system that went way down there. Very healthy. This is actually very heavy. This, folks, is the power of compost. Yep, you can add all kinds of weird stuff to your garden, but you know what? When it comes right down to it, compost is the best thing you could possibly add to it. And here is photographic proof, video evidence. Yep, this is called pumpkin on a stick. Okay, I gotta get going, everybody. Thank you for joining me in the garden for another autumn harvest try to say that really quick. An autumn harvest garden episode here on the Practice Wi-Fi 712 channel. Have a great day, everybody. Bye. I need a bigger dog to help me carry this stuff. You're too tiny.